are the Org. Our mission is to assimilate Star Trek The Next Generation, Star Trek Deep Space Nine, and beer. Lots of beer.
You're listening to a Geek Planet Online community podcast. For more free entertainment, including podcasts and videos, visit us at geekplanetonline.com.
Hello, friend!
Hello!
Welcome to bOrgCast 10.9. And we have a parish notice. Hello to Chris.
Hello.
What we met at the Black Dog Shindig.
Yes.
A week or so back. Good to meet you, sir.
Yes.
It's always great to bump into people who listen to our bizarre ramblings.
Yeah, and even more so to find out that we got you into Star Trek. That's cool.
Yes. Let's move on to tonight's episode. And the first one is A Simple Investigation.
Law.
You tried to break into the station computer. Why?
And order.
Oh, I can't believe what I got myself into.
You have to trust me.
I do trust you.
Passion.
I don't really want to leave this room.
And secrets.
She's not who she seems to be.
Lies can be deadly.
As soon as we got the crystal, she dies.
But you can't protect me forever.
On the next Star Trek Deep Space Nine.
That's a Caption City weirdness trailer.
Yes, yeah, suddenly the trailers have massive captions across them. It's very like headlines.
Law. And order. Passion and fruit or something. I don't know.
Yes, possibly. You can check them out on YouTube. They're bizarre.
Yeah. So you open with a hooded man who puts something up his sleeve.
For now. Is it a wizard sleeve? Oh God, it's going to be a long night. I've had a lot of beer already.
Wow. Okay. And then two blokes appear.
Hey, this is Tradie. They never get named. Tradie, yes. One of them's called, the tall one's called Tradie. And he's played by John Durbin, who was Sestar, the Sele in Lonely Among Us. Remember that? Lizard guy. First season, Next Generation.
I am the Lizard King.
I am the Lizard King, yes. He was also Gulamek in Chain of Command. Remember him?
Yes, but yes. I didn't recognise the actor.
Uh-huh. And he was also in two episodes of Season 5 of The A-Team, which we haven't got to yet.
Season 4, so yes, we haven't seen that yet.
We're looking forward to that. And then the shorter guy is Sorm. Sorm? It's almost more. Played by Nicholas Wirth, who was the Lesepian captain in Progress, way back in Season 1 of Deep Space Nine. Looking blank. He'll be in Voyager, along with the X-Files. Sam Raimi's Darkman, which I've not seen for years. Must track that one down. Knight Rider, Street Hawk. And a load of other TV as well.
Okay.
They're a lovely deadpan double act, aren't they?
Yes.
They're probably the best thing about this episode by a long way.
Yeah. They want what a hooded man, who we later found out is Tarvin Rem. They want what he's got. And he says... Initially, he says, you know, he hasn't got it. He doesn't know what they're talking about. And then somebody says he has. And then, the short dude. Was it Sorm?
He's Sorm, apparently, yes.
Sorm shoots him and just vaporises him. And then he looks at it and goes, oh, I thought it was on stun. And then the other dude turns around and says, look what you did to the carpet.
Yes, that's a great line.
Brilliant. And then we're in Quarks and Julian's got a new... I don't know what it's really called in real life, but in my brain, they're Armand Bashir stories, but it's a holosuite programme.
Yes. Although this, interestingly, was going to be when they introduced a certain holographic nightclub singer.
Oh, yeah.
It's the same guy who created this 007 adventure that creates that person.
Okay.
But the script was too long, apparently.
Okay.
So they stuck with 007 for now. Although references are kept to a minimum as the producers have been threatened by legal action from MGM after Armand Bashir. Yes.
Yeah. And Odo was originally lined up to play a particular character and then, you know, he just says, no, he won't play. And he sort of leaves rather awkwardly and spots a woman at the bar who says, are you waiting for someone? And she's like, thinks it's a chat-up line. And he's like, no, you were looking at the door. Are you waiting for someone? And then she spots a cheat. It's a dude with a magic ring of magicness.
For not.
Two magic ring to go with a wizard sleeve.
Yes. God. Not going to look at the bloody first teaser yet.
And who Quark hasn't spotted because he's trying to chat her up. But Odo's like, you're observant. And she mentions that he has bedroom eyes, which he doesn't quite understand. And then he goes to leave, but he nearly walks into the wall where the sticker is from the FCA. And it's all slightly awkward. And that's the teaser, which was really long and didn't actually have much in it.
Arguably. Although I have to say, I quite like the double act of the shifty guys. They make it out like it's going to be all about, you know, sort of these threatening guys, but they're not in it as much as they need to be, really.
No.
Arissa is played by Dae Young, who was Hannah Bates in Next Generation's Masterpiece Society.
I thought I recognised her for something.
Yeah, she was the scientist that wanted to leave, yeah, if you remember, and would bugger all it up because it was all a finely balanced genetic mix. She'll go on to appear in Enterprise, was in X-Files, and was Amy, Amber Mendes' character as friend in Running Man. You know, the one that makes the comment about Arnold Schwarzenegger, you know, he's always all muscles and maybe he'll kill you and rape you, or rape you then kill you. It's all very tastefully done.
Yeah, I have seen Running Man and a few times, but I don't remember it well enough to know who some of the side characters are.
Yeah, I mean, she literally is in a couple of scenes, so...
Yeah. So you're in the cargo bay. Kira has a gag-related injury.
Yes! How rare is that?
And Odo keeps looking at his reflection all the time, trying to see if he does actually have bedroom eyes. And then in his office, she's there. She was trying to hack the computer, and he points out the data port, and he's rigged a thing so that with a data port it'd be really uncomfortable, and she's like, yeah, I found that, you know. And they kind of compliment each other on how good they are at their jobs and what they do, and while still flirting, and she says she's helped, you know, she's trying to locate her daughter.
I don't see it. He's not flirting with her. He has no idea at this point, bless him. He's a complete innocent.
I don't think he necessarily realises he's flirting with her, but he is.
No, I mean, he accidentally gives lines that would indicate that he is,
yeah,
and she interprets them that way, and then he looks really shocked when, yeah, she tells him, oh, yeah, it's like, well, all I meant was.
Yeah.
He's so sweet.
So then Odo's like, right, okay, I'll help you. So they go to try and find Tarvid. And the two bumbling idiots have tried to cover up the residue with a chair.
Yes, subtly. It's like dropping wine on a white carpet, isn't it? Oh, you put the chair over there, nobody will ever know.
Do you remember that time we had an anniversary meal at the Chinese restaurant and I spilled sweet and sour sauce over the entire tablecloth? So I got that hot plate thing,
yes,
and I just put it over the stain.
Covered up the stains with the hot plate, yes.
And then they came along and took the hot
plate away. And we never went back to Southwest London again.
We certainly never went back to that Chinese.
It was a shame. It was a nice Chinese, though.
It was, yes. But I can remember asking you, and you going, oh, we can't go in there. You dyed their tablecloth orange.
Yes. I completely forgot about that. Oh, dear.
So Odo decides to drop the charges. And this is where I think he must, on some level, know now what's going on, in terms of how he feels about her and the flirting and everything, because he wouldn't normally drop charges for anybody.
Yes, arguably now he's being influenced in the same way that he has been by Kira in the past, and giving her leeway that he would never give anybody else. So yes, even if he doesn't recognise it in himself, he has feelings towards her at this point, so yeah.
And she's free to go. So she goes to access the data elsewhere. Where is this, where she accesses it? This time she succeeds.
It's random corridor of computerness. Okay. We have seen this particular bit of the set before, but yeah. Basically, any time they want to do something computery, they show this bit of the set.
And then Quark closing the bar and evicting Morn, who wanted to lock in.
Yeah, bless him, and who could blame him?
And then Arissa appears, sort of sneaking in, but Odo's there. He's followed her. So even if he had feelings for her, he still didn't trust her.
He's wise.
Caught her in the act, and he's like, you haven't got a daughter, have you? And it turns out that Dimebar, or whatever his name is, that she's...
Dimebar? What? Dimebar?
He's called Dime or something like that. My brain went to a Dimebar place. Sorry, I've been thinking of chocolate all day.
Okay. Yeah, but Dimebars are yuck.
They got Camarel in.
Yeah, barely. Anyway,
she's been working for Dimebar, who works for the Orion Syndicate, and it's like, you don't get to leave the Orion Syndicate. And she was stealing information for him, and she wants out. And she knows, you know, she was trying to get this teeny tiny crystal, but she doesn't know what's on the teeny tiny crystal. So Odo's like, yeah, but you could testify against him. You know, we could track him, we could put him in prison. So he puts her in protective custody.
It's quite clever the way he does that as well, isn't it?
Which is, and she takes her to her quarters and then teleports out, which I like, but into mm-hmm. his, and it's like, oh, come on. And basically she tells a bit about her life story about how she was some sort of telepathic whore, which I don't entirely
understand. Yeah, no, an interesting phrase, which they don't explore, but it's net
something
girl.
Like net girl,
it
yeah.
is net girl, yes, and you're letting men into your mind, which is, you know, it's curious, yeah, future prostitution thing, yeah.
It reminds me of, what was that film? Was it Her?
Uh-huh.
And you have that sort of...
He falls in love with his phone, effectively.
Yeah, but you have that scene fairly early on where it's him and her...
Oh, yes, he's having some sort of, yes, dalliance with... Yes, it's been too long since we've seen
and
that.
And then
yeah.
it's all sort of supposedly for both of them going well, and then she says something really bizarre like, hit me with a bag of cats or something, and then it just...
Yes, it all goes horribly wrong.
It does.
Drain, by the way, not dime bar, but drain.
Oh, the drain, okay.
No, well, right, that's closer. I mean, that I could understand drain, but dime bar?
Yeah, sorry. I probably meant to write Dame, D-A-I-M, and wrote it the wrong way
There
around.
Ain't nothing like a Dame, nothing in this wheel. Oh, God, no, not musicals.
Oh, right.
Tell them I'm pissed, I'm singing songs from musicals.
Yeah. And then... You know, she's sort of like, why are you helping me? Why are you doing this? And he likens her working for Dame Edna Everidge.
really?
Sorry. To he's working for the Cardassians.
Yeah, which is a nice sort of like tie into a few episodes ago. You know, it's this is a current thing. So that's quite
and
cool.
he admires her courage for walking away.
Mm-hmm.
And then, obviously, he's gone out and... for work and stuff, and he comes back in and you have a horrible cheesy moment where you get
hello,
is it me you're looking for? I can see
it. Yes,
yeah. cheesy,
that will not be our play out tune.
No.
And
then they have a conversation because they sort of start talking and various other things, and basically he's sort of a virgin-ish in that he hasn't had sex with a woman before, but it's clear from his description that linking with the great link is sexual.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the first time we find that out.
Kind of, yes. You could have read it into it, but this is the first time it's been pointed out, yes. Poor old René had to shave his upper body for this scene. Which I suppose could have been worse.
Yeah.
and Ronald D. Moore wanted to have done this when Odo was a solid.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure it makes much difference. And in fact, of course, the idea of sex with changeling is, in some ways, well, certain advantages. Let's face it. How long would you like it, darling?
don't worry about your wizard sleeve. I can expand.
Well, indeed, yes.
She's talking about... umming and ahhing about testifying or whatever, and she says she doesn't want to spend... She says, I don't want to spend the rest of my life...
Looking back over my shoulder.
Did it? Oh, that's a nice tune. Oh, we might be playing out on that one. Yes.
Well, it's better than bloody Lionel Richie.
It is better than Lionel Rich Tea Biscuit, yeah.
Yes. Yes. And basically, the moment she said that, I was like, tune!
Yeah. Okay.
Okay?
Very good. Very good.
Right.
Yes, I approve.
Anyway, then, well, it looked to me like the same dude again, but apparently it's a different Idanian dude.
I know, they do look very similar. It is a bit confusing. The first time I watched it, I assumed it was the same, but I thought, didn't that guy just get vaporised on the carpet?
Yeah.
But no, it is another guy.
And basically, Arissa is a sleeper agent, and what's on the crystal is her memories. And then she, meanwhile, is, you know, trying to be in control of her own future, so she's going to give the crystal to Dame Edna Everidge. And there's the two guys, and the tall one is like, you know, it's, you know, I've got no weapon or whatever, because of course his mate's round the corner with the gun.
With his head blatantly sticking out over the containers he's supposedly hiding behind. I don't know how she didn't see him, but never mind.
But it doesn't matter because Odo's there and jumps them.
Literally.
She gets rescued, And he totally prawns them, doesn't he?
He does. Yep, yeah. Odo in action. Excellent.
Yep.
And so then she has her memory transfer via the data port and surgery. And she is an Idanian.
She gets to wear purple.
Yes.
That's an Idanian thing, apparently. Perhaps you're secretly an Idanian.
I'm not sure I like spiced pudding.
Yes, I believe that was actually written in. These are the self-same Idanians who came up with the spice pudding. Bizarre, isn't it?
Yeah.
They obviously like the name, bless them. Don't like the bumpy foreheads, though. It's like, oh, God, did you just find that lying around on the Voyager set or something?
Yeah. You know, why do they never do something with, like, I don't know, an extra arm?
Exactly. It's always the forehead. It's not like, you know, extra kneecap or, you know, a hump or something. Yeah. It's got to be foreheads, apparently.
Yeah. Although they did... Sometimes they've experimented and failed, like the one with a handle for on his face and he couldn't eat properly.
That wasn't good, no. Phallic cop or something.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah. Yes. Yes, and she comes to see Odo to say she's married. And he's like, you know, don't apologise, you didn't know. But he's like, will I see you again? And it's like, no. It's clear that, no, you won't. So it's a sort of bittersweet ending, but...
Just slightly, yeah. Poor kid. Odo punched in the stomach once again. Rene did point out to Ira Stephen Bear that they really seem to enjoy torturing Odo on a regular basis.
Yeah.
He ain't wrong, blimey. No. Apparently it was inspired by the 1952 film The Narrow Margin, which has a similar premise. And it did rather remind me of that Persuaders episode we watched recently where Roger Moore ends up as a sort of sleeper agent.
Yeah.
Yes. Check out Twice as Bright, Half as Long to learn more about that.
So yeah...
It's very slow to get going, isn't it? There are a lot of scenes with just Odo and Arissa. But the two bad guys had been in it more often, they were really well written. Quite unusual for, you know, Star Trek bad guys to be written that well. I was like, I wanted to see more of them, really, rather than the long scenes with Odo.
They should have done a sort of Oh Brother, Where Art Thou, shouldn't they, with those two dudes. Kind of would have worked.
In what way?
Well, you need to find a third one, but basically a bunch of idiots escaping.
Yeah, I'm not sure they're that idiotic, but they're just so wonderfully deadpan. That's what I like about them. They're like, you know, they're not, you know, moustache-twirling villains. And he seems genuinely annoyed that he has to kill such a beautiful-looking woman, but it's the job, so he's going to do it, you know. I quite like that.
The thing is, the other one is clearly not that clever, because when he's cleaning his weapon, the tall one pushes it gently away from him.
Don't point that in my direction.
The thing is, what bugs me is you've got all this awesomeness of the arc plot and everything that we were dealing with in our last episode. Do you get this?
It's a change of gear, I think it's fair to say.
But it's GNDN.
Only if you feel that the story is about progressing plot rather than character, because obviously this is quite a significant character step for Odo. So it's not GNDN for Odo, but it is GNDN for the overarching arc. Again, if you come into this expecting Babylon 5 style arc plotting, you ain't going to get it so much.
No, I think
it's more... The arc plotting's in the background. They're more interested in exploring the characters as we go along. So we're unsurprisingly having a...
Though, I mean, I think what gets me more is that you've had ones before that have been standalone-ish, but there has been a B-plot or something with the arc element in it. And I really felt that's what this was missing.
This was missing a plot, even. But yes, that's, as I say, my problem with it is those long scenes with Odo and Arissa that aren't broken up by anything at all. This story was massively missing a B-plot. You're quite right on that front. And they could have made it a B-plot that tied into the arc, that would have made people happy as well. It didn't have to be, but ultimately, yes, it definitely needed more plots. Right?
Yeah.
Less
dialogue-heavy. And I would
have
liked then the B-plot to be arc-related, because you're saying that DS9 is different, it focuses more on character. But the ones that I like that do focus more on the character tend to have the arc plot as might be the B plot, but it's there. Mm. Do you know what I mean? And it fits in.
We really aren't going to get that till we hit season 6, just to prepare people. Because, I mean, season 6 is very arc heavy.
Mm. But I'm sure we've had other episodes, though, before now that have had a B plot that's
We've had stuff, but they didn't. The fact there was no B plot at all seems a bit of a bizarre decision in this one. And it feels like it slows it all down. I mean, there is just about enough. the first time I watched it a week ago, and obviously it wasn't the first ever time I watched it, but the first time I watched it in ages, and it was like, oh yes, I do vaguely remember this one, and it was better than I remembered it being. Watching it again tonight, it was like, oh, this is a bit plodding though, isn't it? So yeah, you're quite right, it needed a B plot.
It did.
What did Doreen thinks? I don't remember seeing this before, and I was extremely surprised that Arissa had been changed physically and didn't know who she was. And then for her to tell Odo, with his bedroom eyes, that she was married, my heart almost broke for him.
Aww.
I quite like the bit when Odo takes Arissa into one set of quarters and then transports them both into his own quarters. That was nice. Nice bit of detective work there, wasn't it? But the writers then spoiled that good bit of espionage by having Dax openly gossiping about what Odo might have done with Arissa all night in his quarters.
That's a good point.
You wouldn't necessarily expect people to be in ops, but nevertheless, you do have a point there, yes.
Yeah.
Whoops.
Yeah. What did Parry think?
Hello, Orcs. Parry here to talk about A Simple Investigation. This one I quite liked. About the only thing I thought this was really missing, well, there are two things which gave me issue in this. The first was, now, I kind of look at this episode as a bit of a noir-esque thing. I think that's what they were going for, and you do have quite a lot of kind of film noir hints to this. You've almost got the dame who was troubled the minute she walked into the room, although Odo walked into the room, but there is still that hint, and the sort of colourful hitmen that we have are very much sort of that ilk. The only thing is, I really wish they'd put a bit more of that into the music. If you look at things like the TNG episode, Fistful of Datas, they have a sort of Wild West feel in part of the soundtrack, and in I saw Bride of Chaotica, a Voyager episode, they've gone for a very Buck Rogers cinema soundtrack, and I really wish we did something, not like full on, but a bit hints to that more in the soundtrack. But aside from that, this is a decent episode. It's a really good Odo story. Like I say, it's very much got the noir-esque mystery to it, you know, with Odo, while he's actually the chief of security here, he's very much almost acting like a private detective. You've got the femme fatale who gets into his life, and he falls in love with it. And that's the other sort of part of it, is Odo actually falling for a woman, and there are again some nice touches. So I did like the gossiping, Kira and Dax gossiping, even Sisko's response to it with the and Worf kind of complaining about them gossiping down in the work pit. But also the fact that Kira was a bit jealous. You got that hint of, they spent the night together. Oh, Odo's too professional for that. So that's an interesting development. But overall, the story is just, I don't remember this one, so I wasn't quite, I knew there was something wrong with her and she was lying, but I couldn't work out what. And so as a result, the story took me along at quite a good pace. I did know he was going to get his heart broken, I just wasn't sure how. I actually thought she was going to betray him, and I thought the episode finished in a much better way, in that she was kind of this deep cover sleeper. One of the other things in it, the data port in the head, I think that's a first for Trek, and it's almost very cyberpunk. But not just that, considering this was the 1990s, I was thoroughly expecting a big long cable going into the data port. That's how things were done in the 90s. No one thought about wireless tech, and so it's really interesting to see them actually have it using some wireless technology. Definitely ahead of its time, but what I do like about Deep Space Nine, indeed, you know, we've mentioned the Orion Syndicate before, is that it's on the edges. So TNG, we were always in sort of, well, we were meant to be in the frontier, but we were always in a very comfortable Federation territory, and we're not here now. There are criminals, there are people who do horrible things just to stay alive. As Odo says, yes, it's easy to be a saint in paradise. Deep Space Nine is not paradise, and the places it runs through are not. And I think this is really emphasised in this episode, where, you know, we've got the world, lovely, happy Federation, the utopia on Earth and within the Federation worlds, but out here in the frontier, there's criminals, there's people forced to do horrible things. I mean, there was a hint that she did some sort of a mind sex thing. That was possibly the impression I took from it. But, and so there are these kind of the seedy underbelly, if you will, of the Federation, and while it's not nice to know it's still there, it makes the world more realistic to know that it's not gone away. It's just been, to an extent, it's like gentrifying an area, it's moved out, and whether it would keep pushing out to the frontiers the more areas gentrified, we don't know, but it's good to see these things. I say, an interesting break again from the big sort of massive plots that we've been having, and we've got that for the next episode as well, so the kind of main, I could see people getting frustrated that the arc plot's not taking any form here, and that we're having to wait to get on with it, but overall I really enjoyed it, so I'll be back shortly to talk about Business as Usual, a Ferengi episode. Hooray, or hooray, depending on who you are.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Yeah, I like the gossip scene as well.
Yes, that's sweet, isn't it? And Cisco's reaction is wonderful, isn't it? It's like, that's good, yeah. Isn't it?
Yeah. And Worf, get on with your work.
Yes.
Not gossiping. And yeah, Kira does look jealous. She does look...
Yeah, a little bit jelly, maybe. Yeah. Maybe.
But I do like your comment about gentrification. And how, so the Orion Syndicate is there, it's just like gentrification, they've moved away. The Federation as gentrifiers.
Interesting.
Interesting idea. I kind of like that, actually.
And yes, cyberpunk for the first time in Star Trek, I think that's fair to say. Yeah, it's interesting stuff. I thought it was quite well handled, actually. It was interesting effects that they used for that. So.
And yeah, the lack of a cable.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah. Cool. Thank you, sir. We've heard from Drew and Tracy.
We just watched A Simple Investigation.
We did indeed, eh? That was a bit of a...
What?
Weirdy, soft one, didn't it?
It's a bit Philip K. Dick, I thought, wasn't it? Like, he erased the memory of the woman and then brought it back at the end.
You're getting right to the end of it already.
Yeah,
I don't quite understand the beginning where, like, Bashir is like, oh, I've got the new holosuite programme, da-da-da.
It's just a B story, isn't it?
Yeah, but... This is why I said to you halfway through, oh, this is not real. This is like a holosuite program.
Yeah.
And then you was like, no, I don't think it is. And I was like, well, what the fuck was the point of like the beginning, like 2 minutes then? Just absolutely make no sense. I didn't get it.
I own no idea.
So Bedroom Eyes.
Bedroom Eyes, yep.
No. Odo's got like sunken, like stared death eyes, isn't he?
Diseased eyes. Yeah,
if he looked at me, I wouldn't be like, "Oh, he wants to go to bed with me." I'm like, "He wants to kill me."
Yes.
Odo and Orisa got it on, didn't they? Right.
They did get it on. Yeah,
they did. And I said to you, "But he's made of liquid, so if he had an orgasm, does that not kind of like make him?"
You know what? There's so many questions about them having sex.
Yeah,
isn't there? I mean, it's like
it just wasn't quite right.
No,
I didn't want to see like Odo having it off. To be honest, it's like no.
I, you know, I just my mind goes to like you know she's like, oh, you know is that all there is? And he's like, hold on a minute, and makes it bigger. I'm talking about his penis.
I get that.
You know, it's just like, it's strange, isn't it?
He can do what he likes. Yeah, to be fair,
he could have three, couldn't he?
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah, it's weird, isn't it?
Yeah. And it was a bit of a weird episode, I think.
Yeah, you know,
at the end.
I know.
Like, Kira and Dax gossiping and, like, Worf getting, like, a bit cheesed off about it because he's not involved, I think. He wasn't getting cheesed off because they were gossiping. He was like, he weren't in there. And then, like, Sisko coming in and being all like, oh, where is Odo? You know, and I said to you, I want to see Odo come in and do like a bit of a skip and a jump.
Yes.
I've just had the shag of my life.
Yeah. Yeah, I
didn't get the bit also when they're in the car and they're in the holodeck or the holosuite and Bashir's doing his like Bond, although in the tux and the white suit, I did go,
yes,
hello,
very nice.
I don't quite get that though. No. Why did like Odo have to go in and like get some advice from Bashir? It's just a bit daft.
I don't think this was a great episode. It wasn't rubbish or anything. It was just like, yeah, okay. What did you reckon?
Yeah, it was a bit meh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a good point.
Shall we leave it there then?
Definitely.
All right then. Let's have a good one next.
Yeah, hopefully.
Lovely. Thank you.
Bye.
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 That's the very definition of meh feedback, isn't
it? Yeah.
And he's made a liquid, so if he has an orgasm...
Yeah, how does that... Well,
it would come back to him, wouldn't it? Because we know that that happens, doesn't it?
Yes, exactly. He can't lose any of his liquid, so...
Well, not permanently. It then comes back to him.
That could be quite messy, couldn't it? Anyway, let's not dwell on that. Thank you, Tracy. I didn't want to see Odo getting it on. I think our son thought he was going to see far more than he ended up seeing.
Yeah.
Like, oh, they're going to have sex now. Don't worry, it's just a 12. You're fine.
Oh, no, now I've been earworm with...
Let's talk about sex, baby. Let's talk about you and me. Let's talk about all the good things and the bad things that may be. Let's talk about...
No. And define bedroom eyes. That's interesting. I don't know. It doesn't float my boat, but, you know.
I don't think that I look at Odo and think he wants to kill me.
No, that's the other extreme, really, isn't it?
They are kind of... I would describe them, I think, more as puppy dog eyes.
Ah, interesting.
When I see Odo, for all of his scowl and everything else, I just want to pat his head.
Right. Okay.
Not that head. The...
Oh! God. Nobody had gone there but you. Really.
You're the one who was talking about magic rings and wizard sleeves.
Yes, perfectly innocently.
Bollocks.
No, we don't dwell on those either.
And we've heard from the Llama God.
Llama God's Lord, Scott Dake, Jack Jake, Noy, Kegig. It was raining in space. Rain in space, maybe a big sigh. Lord walks into my office. Makes me forget, just for a moment, that there's a war going on. Or something like that. I don't know. There's a war happening! Never mind, let's just have a standalone episode anyway. This episode starts off with a little bit of intrigue as a bumpy-headed generic nun gets offed by some Smurfs with chickenpox, and that's always good entertainment value, which nicely sets up a whodunit, so clearly this is going to be an Odo-centric episode from the off. Immediately following that, there's two interesting discoveries. The first is that clearly the crew of the station don't really have any issues with their favourite eugenics boy, so that's something. It's nice to know that Starfleet isn't completely racist. And secondly, when the femme fatale for the episode walks in, we discover that Odo has bedroom eyes, apparently. He's somewhat baffled as to what this could mean, but I take it to mean that, you know, his eyes could indeed become bedrooms. He's a shapeshifter, you know, so they could become anything. Old on sweet eyes, Odo. Yeah, that brings a new meaning to the word stink eye. Anywho. Yeah, so Odo starts looking off the girl. He takes her back to his bedroom, because of course that's what anyone would do. The dog. I mean, he could be a dog as well. There's anything he could be. Anything. And one thing that immediately struck me, which is kind of resolved by the end of the episode, but still interesting that it's portrayed in this way anyway, is that Odo's meant to find her attractive. So, of course, she's attractive. Which means she looks kind of human. No alien makeup. Unlike the chickenpox guys that we saw at the start. That's a very human-centric notion of attraction, especially given that Odo's not human and he hangs around with a lot of aliens. This is an interesting bit of prejudice on the parts of the writers. And although we find out at the end of the episode, of course, that's not her natural appearance, it's interesting that she's not portrayed as Klingon or a Ferengi or anyone else. It's clearly human. Human that racist Odo has the hots for. So, yay, racism in here somewhere or something. I don't know. Maybe I'm looking too deeply into this. And I guess I kind of have to, because although this episode is a fun romp, it's weird and kind of out of place. This really feels like a season one episode, and it just doesn't belong at this point in the... in what passes for the story arc that Deep Space Nine has. We've been building up some tension a few episodes ago, and it's kind of immediately run out of steam. It's not doing well. But at least there's some intrigue, mainly in that it raises the big question of how exactly does Odo have sex? I mean, he can shapeshift to be anything, so, I mean, for her pleasure, that's got to be quite good. But how does a changeling know when they're finished? You know, they're talking about completely different biology here, and as we've seen, and as they go on to show us, changeling intimacy is very different. Yeah, sex is generally a result of a biological function. This is odd, and raises too many questions. The big question, though, is when we see them lying together in the bed. And they both look exhausted. Of course they are. If Odo's exhausted, he shouldn't be worried about which of them is going to be lying in the wet patch. He should be worried about becoming the wet patch. I mean, yeah, that's interesting. Constable wet patch, eh? Interesting. Anyway, let's see if the next episode can get us back on track, shall we?
Constable Wet Patch. There's the title.
Yeah. Are you going to spell Constable with a U?
No, I am not. Behave. The idea. His eyes become bedrooms. What?
No.
Oh, really?
And in terms of how does he know that he's finished? Well, he's satisfied.
Yeah, but the biological... how does that work?
With... well, the biological functions are obviously different, but that doesn't mean there aren't any.
In other words, he's knackered.
Well, no, he...
I've had enough.
He experiences a lot of pleasure and, I suppose, then he's shattered. Or, you know, he experiences a lot of pleasure in a sort of crescendo kind of thing. But there's not necessarily a...
really, piece. I do not want to dwell on this right now. Oh, my.
There are more questions than answers. Pictures in my mind, but they're not shown. There are more.
We've had that one before.
We have, sadly, yes. But I think it's very apt.
Yeah.
Shall we move on to our next episode very swiftly? Considering what everybody seemed to want to dwell on. Unsurprisingly. Oh, yes. So our next episode is Business as Usual.
Opportunity knocks.
You want me to sell weapons, don't you?
The riskier the road, the greater the profit.
With an offer Quark can't refuse.
It's no different than selling sandwiches.
Don't ever cross me.
But the price of success...
I haven't broken any laws.
I will nail you to the wall.
...is devastating.
$28 million debt?
On the next Star Trek Deep Space Nine.
Yeah, it's particularly distracting having Opportunity Knocks comes up in big letters because you're expecting Bob Hopeless at that point. Anyways, Quark has just lost big time on the stock market, including his quadrochicicale futures. It's a nice reference to Trouble with Tribbles. And
but how was he trading with the FCA Hoobly thing?
Yeah, interesting thought. I presume this is outside the Ferengi commerce. This is over, you know, a different stock market, presumably. And there must be billions of them thinking about it. He's also lost on his powdered newt supplements as well.
Really?
Yes. He's up to his lobes in debt and will lose the bar. Then to add to his woes, Cousin Gala turns up. You know, the one who owns the moon that's been referenced a few times up to this point.
He's the one who gave him the shuttle that led to Little Green Men.
Exactly, yes. He's played by Josh Pace, who's no stranger to latex, as he was both...
Fanar.
You know, I wasn't even going there, but okay. As he was both the voice and in the suit of Raphael in the first Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles movie. How embarrassed do you feel now, you Fanar? He's offering Quark a job, despite the FCA.
Oh, come on, no stranger to latex, please.
Yeah. Well, what latex? What's latex got to do?
Condoms are made of latex, you twit.
Are they?
Yes.
I did not know that.
So no stranger to latex.
Oh, okay.
You could perhaps have phrased that differently.
I could have done if I'd have made that connection, but I didn't. I was going for Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. As unsexy as you can think of.
What does it say about me? What does it say about you?
Indeed.
What do you think of when you think of latex?
Turtles.
Most people, condoms. You, turtles.
Heroes in a half shell.
Anyway.
Are we playing out to that?
No. He's offering Quark a job.
You can't get over the fact that that's where your brain went. Latex.
Is, obviously. Despite the FCA ban, and of course, it's a weapons smuggling deal. Entertaining the clients as they come in. And in a month, he could own his own moon. Because that's what it's all about, owning your moon. Nope, okay. Meanwhile, at the O'Briens, Miles... we get a B-plot in this one. Hooray! Miles isn't getting much sleep. Thanks to Kiriyoshi not sleeping. Keiko's
You've got
away.
His name this time, you're not calling him the...
yeah. Well, whatever we call
him. Maru.
No, yeah. Keiko's away, and the babysitters had to cancel, so he's stuck with him. Jake offers to sit, having sat for our favourite off-screen parent, Ensign Pran, But as soon as Miles leaves the baby, the Bab cries, so he ends up taking him with him to work, as you do.
Your baby to work, don't you?
Exactly. Quark is paranoid about Odo finding out about the arms deal when Haggaff arrives. You recognise this guy?
I do, but I don't know where from. And his name sounds like a red dwarf Gelf.
It is... It is Stephen fracking back off! A.K.A. bad guy from so many movies, including Beverly Hills Cop. No?
Uh-huh.
Octopussy?
Is Octopussy the one where he plays a Russian badly?
Yes, he's a Russian general. Yeah.
Badly. Yeah. Very badly.
It is. Most of his performances could be defined as badly. And this is one of them, sadly. It's a typical... he starts okay, gets gradually more over the top as we go on. Anyway, the holosuite is full of weapons to show off, but they're all replicas, so they're not doing anything illegal here. Quite how you can sell somebody a replica weapon and say, yeah, this is what the actual one's going to be like. I mean, that sounds like a con in the making, doesn't it? But anyway, Gala generously credits Quark with thinking of this wheeze. We see Quark doing a successful sales pitch with some tall dude, and he decides it's no different to selling sandwiches, which is a bit worrying, isn't it, really? Miles is playing darts with his baby in his arms.
Has he not heard of a sling?
Apparently not. They don't have them in the future. But apparently this thing didn't work. They should have, you know, mentioned that at least, shouldn't they? Because that would have made life a lot easier for him.
Yeah.
Although they are hell on the back, if I remember rightly.
But it depends where you wear them.
And how big the baby is. And this is only a small one, so it shouldn't have been an issue. But anyway, no. He needed a papoose. Apparently...
Is a papoose about this hoose?
Apparently, Miles hasn't put the baby down for a week, which must have made toilet trips fun. Quark is being given umox by Haggaff's companion, Tallulah.
She doesn't say anything, does she?
No, she's a non-speaking part, but she gets a name, which is more than that detective guy got in the last episode, but never mind. Don't stop until you see smoke, he tells her. Bloody hell. Odo arrives, and this is nicely shot upside down, because, Quark's on his back as Odo walks in. And he's going to arrest him because he doesn't have a license to sell weapons, but then Quark points out he's not actually selling weapons on the station, which is something of a technicality. Sisko arrives to demand that Quark set free on behalf of the Bajoran government, since Haggaff supplied arms to the resistance back in the day, which is a nice bit of planning on his part, I guess. The captain still threatens to nail Quark to the wall if he so much as litters, though.
This is what I don't get, because as Kira says, they would all be dead if there hadn't been someone willing to sell them
weapons.
So she shouldn't have a problem with what Quark's doing.
She doesn't, in a way.
Yeah, but that's not what the body language...
No, she still knows he's crossing a line here, interesting. Because he's selling them to anybody. And as far as she's concerned, I mean, that would include the Cardassians. If they would have quite happily sold to the Cardassians had asked. So, her issue is with the... And I think all of their issue is with the non-discerning selling of weapons. So anybody who's got money can buy them. So if they were just selling to people, as Quark tries to claim later on, for defensive purposes, they wouldn't have had a problem. If it was just sort of rebellious types trying to overcome horrible overseers, they probably wouldn't have had a problem. The fact that they're selling to literally anybody,
but that's never including, explicitly said.
I don't know. It's kind of. I mean, some of their customers are not exactly the most reputable people, are they? And particularly not the region that we meet later on. But
no, I know. And
more of that later.
But that I can understand. But at this stage...
Mm-hmm. But I think that's part of... It's kind of part of the story is to try and sell you on the fact that, Quark isn't being too revolutionary to start with. And he's just gradually sort of sucked into this until he does reach his breaking point, which I think is the really nice bit of the story is to say, he's a Ferengi. He will make profit, but actually he does draw the line somewhere.
Yeah. But I just didn't, particularly the way Kira's behaving, given that this dude has helped them.
She just wants his arse nailed to the wall. I mean, that's what you can see it on her face, can't you? Okay.
And with Sisko as well, are they not interested in weapons that might help them defeat the Dominion?
No, I don't think they are, because I think not necessarily Sisko, of course, but certainly Starfleet has principles.
Yeah, but with Sisko, that's what I'm thinking. You know what Sisko's like already, yeah. Mr. Mr. Fucking Genocide.
Yeah, yeah, but he's also Mr. Control, and Quark's clearly getting rather out of control at this point. But anyway, Haggath's Saxon employee with Burkhoff, he was good up until now, and then he starts doing his usual shouty stick. Anyway, we later find out the dude gets exploded up in his ship on the way back. Quark observes that he hasn't had any Federation customers, and Galen says he's thinking of stepping down and letting Quark take his place. Dax won't speak to Quark in the Replimount either, despite him feebly attempting to defend himself. Bashir has tested Kiryoshi, and the diagnosis is premature awareness of life's existential isolation.
Yeah.
In other words, depressed baby is depressed. Aww.
Life. Don't talk to me about life.
Bizarrely, having used the wardroom where, you know, all the crew have their meetings in, they're selling their weapons there? That makes no sense. Bizarre. And then another very painful performance. It looks like Haggath is going to lose it over Quark's catering arrangements for the visiting regent that they're hoping to sell weapons to. But it's all a joke! Ha! And indeed, ha.
It's like a fifth-rate Fifth Element, isn't it?
Really? Oh, yeah. I'm amazed he wasn't in the Fifth Element, actually. He would have fitted right in, wouldn't he? Bloody hell. Haggath tells Quark that he loves him.
Aww.
That's a bit of slash fic that we didn't need to know about, really. The Regent, when he arrives, is played by Lawrence Tierney. Did you recognise him?
I did, but I couldn't tell you where from.
He was Cyrus Redblock. Who? The Big Goodbye, which we watched relatively recently in Season 1, Next Generation. See, it was worth watching those first season episodes.
No.
No, it wasn't. he was in loads of 1940s films as well, so you may have spotted him when you were around your nan's place in some black and white film. In this, he was recovering from a stroke, bless him, and had to have help delivering his lines. He's been betrayed by his second-in-command, and he wants to make an example out of her by wiping out 28 million in her city over time. Quark is clearly shocked as they discuss a virus-based weapon. Galen tries to persuade him it's just numbers, just a few out of billions in the US. I mean, this is a really good scene where he sort of looks out, oh, look at all those stars, and just one of them blinks out. Would anybody notice? And it's like, ooh.
But it made me think of that Monty Python song.
Our galaxy itself contains 100 billion stars. It's 100,000 light years side to side. It bulges in the middle, 16,000 light years thick, but out by us, it's just 3,000 light years wide. We're 30,000 light-years from galactic central point. We go round every 200 million years. And our galaxy is only one of millions of billions in this amazing and expanding universe.
We might go down that route, you never know. I don't think we've had that one. We've had Christmas in Heaven, but I don't think we've had that one. Anyway.
But that's when he was doing that, that's exactly yeah. what I thought of. When he was, and in my head, he suddenly became Eric Idle.
Quark has a nicely shot nightmare about all the crew of the station dying as a result of his actions. Again, it's a nice direction, and it's one Alexander Siddig who's directing this episode, his first directing job. So, not a bad job, sir. O'Brien is keeping his baby in the pit in Ops. To keep him sleeping, because apparently it's a nice restful place. The fact that it's kind of in the middle of the computer core is a bit of a distraction.
It looks like a car seat, and that was one of the few places we could get Leah to sleep, wasn't it?
Well,
was
yeah,
a car seat?
Yeah, no, they do have a futuristic car seat complete with blinky lights for no good reason, and it's kind of spaceship shaped, which I like. Sisko tells him to take a few days off.
Yeah.
I like the fact that the entire crew of Ops is just gathered round the pits. It's like, get on with your work. Quark suggests purchasing a different virus that's quite slightly less effective. And then gets the Regent's mortal enemy on the station, showing Galen and saying that they'll buy the virus too. And then he gets his cousin to share into the same cargo bay as...
Regent.
The Regent, yeah. Leading to a firefight, which annoyingly we don't see, because that would have been quite cool, but cunning thinking on Quark's part, of course. Worf goes to see the Chief to complain about him not pimping out the Defiant, and Miles explains he's having to take some time off to care for the baby, despite still being in his uniform.
How has he got changed when he's always holding the baby?
You could argue that, I suppose. Yes, no, fair enough. That's logical. I mean, I did used to find that the worst thing you could do whilst holding a baby be wearing a cassock, which, let's face it, is black. And what colour is baby sick generally?
sort of whitish. White,
yes, that's why I started wearing the scapula, which generally only monks wear. It's a clerical bib, basically, and it covers up sick quite nicely, I discovered. Anyway, he gets Worf to hold the baby, and the wee guy stays silent. It's nicely played and very touchingly. The Klingon reflects regretfully that he never saw his son at that age, which is like a poignant moment, really. And then O'Brien falls straight asleep, of course. Yeah. I know that feeling. Sisko is bawling Quark out for causing the chaos in the cargo bay and tells him he's going to pay for the damage. Apparently Gala and Hagaf got away, though the regent is dead. Is Quark bothered? Apparently not. Yes. Quite how, you know, Sisko's going to bill Quark for damage. Nah, let's not dwell on that.
Doesn't work, does it?
No. Quark ends up playing cards with Dax again, so he's been welcomed back into the fold with his cunning plan. And ultimately, I think it's a lovely, cool exploration of where Quark's boundaries are. You know, he is a Ferengi, but he's been influenced by humans now. It's, you know, 5 years down the line, and he does have certain boundaries. And he's not the cold-blooded Ferengi that some of his compatriots are. Apparently this was a favourite of Armin Shimerman. You can see why. It's a wonderful performance from him. And I do love that B-plot as well, which is really sweet. And our son was... Because our son is big on babies. You know, he just melts if there's a baby in the room. And every time Kiryoshi's on screen, he's like, oh! Distracted him from the bloody cat bringing mice in every 5 minutes.
Oh, yeah, freaky cat. Yeah. What gets me, though, is all the way along... It's like, oh, I'm going to kill people who cross me. And so Quark's like, oh, what's Galen going to do? Or maybe kill me. And then he's like, yeah, it's fine. So not Galen. Sorry, Hagaf. Mm-hmm. Made me think of other bald dude.
Oh, Picard's old professor, you mean?
No. In Babylon 5. I think that's his name. Or maybe not. Anyway, I called him the wrong name because he reminded me of a different bald person. anyway, him, he keeps saying he's going to kill him. You know,
he doesn't get an opportunity, does he? Because the point that which Quark reveals he's crossed him, at that point there's like a massive phaser fight. I mean,
yeah, but when he kills the other dude, it's because his shuttle blows up, so presumably he's got connections. So why is Quark not worried that he's going to be
killed in future, you mean? Yes. I'm surprised they didn't... Hagaf wasn't killed in the firefight, because that would have been a nice... And spoilers, we won't see him again because they can't afford Stephen Berkoff again, thankfully. Oh God, he's so hammy.
Yeah,
he's appalling in this. Just that he's, I say, he's fine until he goes into shouty mode, and it's like, oh really?
Well, it's not just that. He also has the every now and again, as well as shouty, he also goes a bit Shatner-esque and does slightly staccato delivery. Doesn't he?
Yeah, he's clearly not taking it seriously. Bless him.
But is he ever taking anything seriously?
Well, he's a big theatre guy, so I suspect he takes the theatre seriously and the television he uses to fund it, I think, is the way it works. But there we go.
Yeah, but this idea that somebody can be a good theatre actor and then maybe they're not that good on the telly only really worked when telly was a new medium before he was born.
No.
If you shit on the telly, you're probably shitting the theatre as well.
There are those theatre actors who take the theatre very seriously and television is just the way they fund it, so they take the piss when they're on telly.
Oh, so you think he's not trying?
I don't think he is, no. Well, I hope not. Anyway, well, he's a really crap actor.
But that's what I think, though. I think he is trying and he's just totally shit.
Well... we'll need to hear from somebody who's seen him on stage, I guess.
We heard from Doring.
Aha.
He says, I enjoyed this one. Quark, as usual, is excellent. I thought that the plan to get out of arms trading was a little extreme, but perhaps it was the only way.
Yeah, well, it got him out of it.
The B-plot with Miles and his baby wasn't exactly great.
Oh.
Quite like the bit at the end with Dax and Quark. I enjoyed Dax teasing Quark that she wasn't going to give him his wheel back.
Yeah.
I wonder if he ever got it back.
No, I'm sure he didn't.
No, not from Dax.
I'm really sure. Sorry. How did the God of Llamas cope with this one? Let's find out.
Llama God's Log Supplemental. We return to the action of the war as we discover that Quark is broke. I don't know whether it's the episode itself or the fact I received an annoying text just before starting to watch the episode. I've got no time for this episode at all. And it's not to do with the fact that focuses on Quark. I love the Ferengi-centric episodes. I love the insight into their cultures, the brief diversion of comedy, but after a couple of episodes that felt quite divorced from the ongoing Dominion Cardassia arc thing, this is not necessary. And again, like the previous episode, it feels like a rejected season one episode, so this is just weird. But I guess then, to at least justify some of this feedback, there was a couple of things that stood out with me. The first, obviously, is that it's Siddiq El-Fadil, not Alexander Siddiq. Interesting. His directorial, is it his directorial debut? I'm not sure. And it kind of shows. I mean, bless him. He's doing the best he can to make a pretty average episode stand out. He does a few interesting things, like, you know, the shot of Quark lying on the bed in the sick bay, you know, this odd camera angle there. So he's doing his best, but then some of the other scenes show his newness as the director, the Quark dream sequence, given that, obviously, you know, Quark has now become one of the tools of the prophets, much like the Cisco. During that sequence, we see the various characters walk around Quark, but they do the kind of walking around in and out camera, spiralling him thing. It's a well-established directorial trope, and it's, yeah, I guess it's the first time he's playing with it, but yeah, there's nothing that hugely fresh or interesting about this episode in terms of the direction, so he gave it his best shot, but to be fair, when the material was that weak, yeah. And the only other interesting thing to me, really, is Dax, really. And the fact that Dax, this episode, seems to be disappointed when she discovers that Quark is Quark. I mean, she's hung out with him for long enough, and she's always the one who's championed the Ferengi, but when he actually starts going full-on Ferengi, yeah. I mean, what's going on there? Was she kidding herself? Did she think that the Ferengi, Quark, her friend, was actually trying to adopt her own morals? Is it that she only likes the Ferengi when they're more human? Is this an evidence of more Starfleet prejudice? Or is it, though, that the case is that, you know, arms dealing is extreme even for most Ferengi? Although, you know, it's clearly against Starfleet codes of conduct, I don't think it's established in this episode particularly strongly whether this is a taboo in the Ferengi culture itself or not. I don't know. Or maybe it's just the fact this is a badly written episode. So, yeah, I really don't have much more to say about that, other than the fact that it's also a waste of Stephen Berkoff as well. But, yeah, there we go. Even he couldn't save it, despite doing his best to chew what was available scenery. Never mind. Oh well. I am sure, however, that I will enjoy listening to both of your responses to this whilst travelling on the road. So, glory to you and your cast.
Thank you, sir. Waste of Stephen Berkoff. Apparently he has seen him on stage then, because yeah. I've not seen anything that Stephen Berkoff has done that hasn't been a piss take, to be honest. So no. There we go. Yeah, Quark, I don't think Quark has been this mercenary up until this point.
No, and I do wonder whether perhaps arms dealing is extreme even for Ferengi, because we get no indication that Quark has ever done it before, even when he was new to Federation and exposures of the Federation.
And not only that, but Cousin Gala seems to be a sort of standout character because he's willing to do these big, you know, arms deals. So I think it is kind of unusual. But, yeah, that could have been spelled out more clearly.
It could have been. But when you think back to that episode where Quark is defending the Ferengi culture to Sisko against humans and says things like, we've never had slavery. On Ferenginar, then obviously there are limits. So if they're not slave traders, then maybe they're also not arms dealers.
Generally. Possibly.
I'm sure there are Ferengi who have traded slaves, that makes sense. Yes. But that's not the same as it being part of your culture.
And clearly there is a risk when you're trading weapons that, you know, somebody's going to use those weapons against you.
Yeah.
So you've got to have a certain degree of moxie and bravery in order to do it. So, or stupidity, arguably.
Yeah.
So you get the impression Cousin Gala isn't the smartest.
It doesn't seem to be.
No. Anyway. Yes, it was Alexander Siddig's directorial debut, and I quite enjoyed it. I suppose, yes, you could argue that. I mean, Luke was a bit confused, wasn't he? He thought that the dream sequence may have been an orb sequence. Yeah. But the lighting wasn't the same, so that's kind of what gave it away to me. Because if you've got an orb sequence, then it's all out of focus, and you know, there's that sort of strange sort of lighting effect going on, whereas this didn't have that. It was shaking the camera around, but, you know, it wasn't a confusion for me. And, yeah, this one's exploring Quark's character. The previous one was exploring Odo's character. That's what Deep Space Nine does, I'm afraid.
Yeah, but again, no arc B-plot.
No arc B-plot, but there is as a B-plot with the baby, which is really sweet.
Yeah, but it's not an arc B-plot. I don't mind.
Well, it is, but, I mean, the baby's been part of the arc. The arc isn't all about the war with the Dominion. That's just it. People assume, if you're going to go down the Babylon 5 route, that it's all about the big galactic conquest thing. And that was never what Deep Space Nine was about. And I, Stephen Baer, was always quite clear about that. That stuff happens, and it, you know, it is part of the arc. But there's loads of arcs that go throughout, you know, and the characters develop, and there's never a reset button. And, you know, this particular one sees, you know, you follow Quark's particular arc as he explores this particular avenue, and it doesn't work out for him, surprise, surprise. And you also explore some of the, you know, O'Brien family stuff.
Yeah, but
without Keiko, result.
Yeah, but again, you could have had other stuff in there. Like, so, for example...
I don't think so. I think
you could. So, for example...
No, I disagree. Because the previous episode, I completely agree, that was too reliant on one plot... And it stuck out as a sore thumb as a result. So I can understand people being irked by that. And it desperately needed to be plot, and preferably one that had some relation to one of the arcs that's been going on, rather than just being Odo's character. This one, to be fair, come on, not only have you got the, you know, the arc of Quark's character, but you've also got the baby stuff.
Yeah, so I would have rather it had... The B plot has got to have more meaning, I think.
Well, can you have more meaning than a man and his baby?
No, than just my baby won't sleep. So I would have... I mean, for example, one thing I've noticed...
And that stuff about Worf and, you know, the fact that he missed out on... You know, he didn't know his son when he was
there.
Yeah,
you see, you could have
had... That's really
touching. Now that I could have gone with, because what I was about to talk about, actually, and what I think in some way would have fitted with this one is something to do with the fact there's loads of Klingons on the station. Supposedly, who we don't see.
Who do in the background, but... Yeah.
Yeah, but the only reference we get is the Gak-related injury.
Yeah, she's nice.
But I would much rather have had... You know, you've got that bit with Worf. Well, have that be introduced sooner. And have Martok there. And because all that's then a visual reminder that he's there commanding the station.
Mm.
And have some kind of conversation with Martok and Worf. With all the stuff that's been going on, have some kind of reference to the baby's on the station because now it's okay for the baby to be on the station because the fleet has gone to Cardassia. You can still reference the proper arc, or have a scene
proper
with Garak and Zial.
Why? What? You're trying to fix too much. An A plot and a B plot is quite enough, I think you'll find. And I was quite happy with it. So,
no, for me it wasn't enough.
Okay, well, I disagree, but there we are.
What did Drew and Tracy think? Did they miss the arc?
So, that was business as usual.
Yes, it was indeed.
And what do we think of that one, then?
Again, not a very good episode.
It was a little bit meh.
Yeah.
Yeah, I kind of lost interest a little bit halfway through.
Yeah.
I don't know. Was it ever likely that Quark was really going to get into selling weapons just because he was, like, almost, well, particularly bankrupt?
Mm.
And, you know, then he swings round and actually he does have morals and he obviously doesn't want people to die. But it was just a bit daft, I think.
Yeah, and then at the end we're like, oh, no, he's back in debt now. How would they have to pay for the cargo bay? The Federation don't use money, do they?
No.
But, you know. Is that Stephen Berkoff? Is that his name?
Oh,
he was so hammy, wasn't he? He just really...
He shouted quite a lot. And he had to be a baddie because obviously he was British.
Yeah, he's just too hammy for the role, isn't
he? Yeah, it was just a bit of a cheesy, like, episode all round. And, like, with O'Brien and the baby.
Yoshi,
yeah. So yes. He actually names his child after a Mario Kart character.
Yeah.
As well, so. But, yeah, and then it turns out that Worf is the one that can pacify the baby. So what? Everyone's held this baby and it cries, yet Worf holds it for 2 minutes and now the chief is able to put it down.
I didn't really understand that bit at the
end.
No, I don't
get it either.
Because he put the baby into
the
cot thing, yeah, and he didn't cry. So was it that the baby had come out of this phase of crying all the time?
No idea.
Or because at first I thought, like you're saying, like, oh no, Worf is the other person. But if he could have just put him in the crib in the first place and he wouldn't have cried, then he would have been okay. So I think they were saying, like, the baby stopped crying.
Yeah, I don't know.
I did, yeah. It's
and
just
also,
a bit silly story.
O'Brien said, oh, I've got to give him his bottle. Went off to get the bottle. Baby's asleep, or baby goes to sleep. And then he goes to sleep. And it's like, actually, should you not feed your child? You could be asleep for, like, the next 5 hours.
The trouble is, I'm just not really worried about knowing what was going on.
I guess. So could... They have really withheld Quark's money. So when they start doing the deal and he starts making some money,
when he's giving it to
and
the,
they said, "Oh, we're going to give it straight creditors. To your creditors." Oh, can they do that?
Do what you want if you're like a person like that, gangster. I guess.
And also, with just going back to the baby, I just thought, why doesn't O'Brien make a fucking papoose from the replicator? Then he hasn't got to hold this child physically.
Yeah, I guess
so. You know, just, it was a bit daft, isn't it? So you've got to physically hold your child 24 hours a day.
I don't know.
Anyway, I didn't like it.
No, I didn't like it. Just
it was a bit vanilla.
Yeah, vanilla episode is a good description.
Yeah. All right, well, it looks like the next one's better.
Yes, definitely.
Okay, see you later. Bye.
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 Yes, why didn't you make a papoose?
Yes.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
And Stephen Berkoff is terrible. There's no he's the most irritating thing about this story.
He is really, just really hammy.
Why? Why did they get him in? But yes, it's not Yoshi. It's not bloody Mario. That's as bad as a bloody Kobayashi Maru.
Yeah. I did think that as well about the bottle. Oh, I've got to give the baby his bottle.
Apparently he didn't. He just fell asleep. Not. Sweet. No, apparently Worf's a calming influence. Who knew?
Tracy.
And now, the Pie Man. Pie.
Hello again. Puri here to talk about business as usual. So, it's another Ferengi episode. I know these. Some people don't like them, some people do. I thought this one was pretty good. I liked the use of Gala as a kind of anti-quark, almost. Or not quite anti-quark. Quark without the Quark's moral centre. Now, he does have one. I know it seems sometimes that he doesn't, but there is a certain moral compass to Quark, as we see in this episode. So, basically, Quark's absolutely skint. He loses all his money. Looks like he's in serious trouble. And his cousin brings him in to be part of a scheme where they're going to use the Holo Suites as a demonstration area for his arms trading. And Quark gets a cut. And they bring in an actor who now, I don't remember his name off the top of my head. I did speak about him on Twitter, though. We had a bit of a discussion about whether he was a good actor or not. He isn't really. He chews scenery a lot in this. I mean, he's kind of your go-to villain. I think I did joke on Twitter that he's kind of the guy, kind of, if you can't get Alan Rickman, Malcolm McDowell, maybe one or two other people, then he's the sort of guy you go for. Buddy in Beverly Hills Cop 2 has a big spot in the middle of his head, which you always want to poke. He was the main villain, and played quite an odd sort of eccentric. He did, I mean, he really kind of went all out on this one, and like I say, there were some scenes where, yeah, you could see the teeth marks in the scenery. He was chowing down. I don't think they were feeding him properly or something, because by gods, he was going for it. But the actual idea is quite good. I mean, this idea that they're conducting arms deals in the station, but they're not actually moving any arms through it, and there is kind of legal grey area. What I liked was part of the reaction of the crew, that they all got really annoyed because this is kind of Quark going too far. Although, I'd argue he's gone too far a couple of times. Remember when he snuck all those people on board who got them through to abduct Dax's symbiote? He got away with that scot-free. But I did like at the end when Sisko kind of said, yes, you owe me, you know, basically Sisko's now got him in debt. And that's obviously Sisko's way of controlling it. In fact, Sisko is good in this episode. Sisko, for all that he's not in it much, you realise why Sisko's such a good commander. So there's that dealing with Quark. The other thing is the understanding he shows O'Brien. Now, we have this subplot where O'Brien is left at home with the baby. And is it Kiriyoshi? They call him Koshi, Yoshi? Anyway, the baby will not is crying if any time anyone other than O'Brien's holding him. Now, my daughter in particular, she was very bad for not sleeping, as in just not sleeping, for about, I think, the first 2 to 3 years of her life. Me and my wife didn't really sleep much, and we were fine, possibly, but she didn't sleep, and, you know, so that sort of thing of when he sort of picks her up and says, no, it's fine, I'll just carry her to work. Genuinely, there were some moments where I thought, I wonder if I can dress her in high-vis, just to give my wife a break. Because we hot bunked and that sort of thing, so I had a lot of appeal for that. And I did like the scene when he's asleep in ops, in the pit in ops, and everyone's looking forward, and Sisko's kind of, you can't leave a baby in ops. And O'Brien's like, but it's working. And Sisko's like, look, take some time off. Seriously, Chief. And he's like, okay, but kind of leave him here until it got... And that scene had me in stitches because some of it is horribly familiar. Yes, I was one of those people who was saying, no, no, it's fine, I'll just keep driving around this car park if she sleeps. So I did like that subplot. It's a gentle nothing subplot, but it was good fun. Gave everyone else a bit of something to do. But overall, again, not much of substance in this episode, aside from perhaps looking at Quark's moral compass, and to an extent the relationship between Dax and Quark. And I did quite like how he tried to sort it out in the Starfleet way by getting the sides together so they could see each other, and they end up trying to kill each other. I thought that was quite a good subversion on how these things often work. So, yeah, overall, I thought fairly well executed. I mean, some of the Ferengi episodes later go to a lot of the squealing and shouts of Moogie, and I think perhaps only having Quark as the main Ferengi here worked quite well. So, yeah, overall, a good couple of episodes. I'm sure it's a bit frustrating for some that we're not moving the main plot along, but I'm quite happy with it. So all that remains for me to say is do keep up the good work. I'm always enjoying the podcast, and I look forward to the next couple of episodes. Until then, bye for now.
Bye,
sir. Yeah, I don't think this would be classed as a comedy Ferengi episode. I think we've got one of those coming up quite soon, but this isn't one of them.
I wouldn't say it's a comedy one. It's a Ferengi episode, but it's not a comedy one.
Oh, no. No, it's a more sort of moral type thing.
Yeah.
And, there's more going on here than just laughs. And it's not the first... You're quite right, it's not the first time he's gone too far, and he got off very scot-free last time, didn't he?
Yeah.
When it came to selling Dax out, basically. But yes, I well remember driving to the Thames Barrier and back again just to make a baby sleep. So maybe there's something in this for people who've had babies that it rings bells, possibly the B-plot anyway.
Well, I've had babies, and it didn't ring... Well, it ringed, but I didn't like the B-plot, really.
Did you not?
It was the sort of thing that I would have had less of, but maybe vaguely in the background-ish for something else that was more interesting. As in more, I'd say more interesting, more action-based, I think is what I mean. Because it would have been a counterpoint to the action. So I think that for me the issue was that it wasn't the right B-plot for this episode.
All right.
Okay. I think I've sort of
it's
refined
it. It's the wrong
it.
B-plot, Grommet.
Yes, so it's okay. Not... My issue isn't so much with the B-plot, mm-hmm. is that...
It didn't work well with the A-plot, apparently.
For me.
Okay. Well, I like this one. Apparently I'm in a fairly small minority. Hey-ho, we shall find out what people think of the next story, which we shall be covering on bOrgCast 10.10, recording Friday the 6th of October. And we'll be covering Ties of Blood and Water.
Oh, it's not that one, is it? No, it can't be.
Okay. And,
we'll have to have an off-air conversation. Okay.
And Ferengi Love Songs, which, from what I remember, is our Ferengi comedy story of the season.
I think so. I know what that one is.
Yes. And lots of cries of Moogie, and yes. There is a possibility, folks, that before then, we may be doing a Discovery special. Potentially. Depends what we think of it, really, and whether we're spitting chips entertainingly, so we'll record it, or just spitting chips so much we don't want to even talk about it, or whether we actually enjoy it, you never know.
Yeah, and whether we've got enough to say about it.
Exactly.
If we're still very much feeling jury's out, there won't be any point in recording something, I don't
Potentially.
Think.
Potentially. The only reason that I think I wouldn't recall something else. I was so cross about it I didn't have words, I think, which is quite possible.
I'm not sure I'd record for meh.
No, I suppose not for meh. But anyway, there may or may not be a... And it'll be very plainly labelled. I've got a scheme in mind for that.
Oh, hell.
Of course I have. So, so yes, that may be coming your way next Monday or Tuesday, depending on when I've got time to edit it. But ultimately, yes, the next main bOrgCast episode will be on the 6th of October. Okay, we'll catch you then. Cheerio, bye.
Bye. The ball.
bOrgCast is brought to you by the lovely people at geekplanetonline.com.
All music referenced is for illustrative purposes only, and no copyright infringement is intended. The music at the beginning of this podcast was produced by the 86th Floor on YouTube and is used with their kind permission.
To contact us, you can use the forums at geekplanetonline.com.
Visit our Tumblr site at bOrgCast.tumblr.com, where you'll find images accompanying the episodes discussed in this cast.
Send email messages or MP3s to bOrgCast@geekplanetonline.com.
Or you can contact us via Twitter on rev_org or bOrgCastAmmo. Hashtag bOrgCast.
Looking back over my shoulder, I can see the look in your eye. Turning my heart over and over, I never wanted to say goodbye. I don't mind everybody laughing, but it's
shut it down!